It's my pleasure to be with you this evening in all the snow and ice. And it's great to be here. But when I was invited and asked to come, I was asked to come and speak about prayer. And there's my father once said to me, the best salesman is someone who believes in the goods they're selling. And I think
quite often when we look at prayer, we can have many different mindsets, attitudes. And I'm one of those children who went to church before I was born. I don't know if there's anyone else like me, but my father was actually the Baptist minister of Bombay Baptist Church in Calaba. And so it was in Calaba Baptist Church in India that I grew up. And there is where I gave my life to Jesus at the age of 4 years old, having prayed a deep sinner's prayer of repenting from my life of crime, sex and drugs. Actually, it was as I was being put to bed, as my dad went down to do the 6:30 Sunday evening service, a wonderful woman was putting me to bed, and I prayed this prayer, a very simple prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, I want you to be as close to me as my pillow is right now. And guess what? It worked. How many of you have prayed simple prayers and found they've changed your life for the rest of your life? Yeah. And you see, so often we look at prayer and we think, I'm not very good at it, can't really do it. But I tonight hope to unashamedly infect you with a virus that you will never get rid of. I want to infect you with a heavenly virus of a passion for prayer. And I am not one of those people who ever thought I was good at prayer. In fact, I used to feel highly embarrassed and somewhat a bit hypocritical when they say, oh, Rachel, you pray. I used to think, oh dear, I'm not really one of those very good prayer people. But I've begun to discover there's no such thing really as one of those wonderful good prayer people. How many of you discovered that? Yeah. Actually, all of us can be carriers of prayer. I also want to break one other rumour that I've heard, and that is that prayer is for old ladies. I believe that vibrant young men make awesome prayers. And I don't believe it's just something that old women, when they haven't got anything better to do in this little hole, and they can do the prayer thing. How many believe prayer needs to come right out the closet into the church, and we need to grasp it? Yeah. And as I said this afternoon, I've got two children. I've got a son who's 25 years old. I've got a daughter who's 28 years old. And both of them are vibrant prayers and love the place of prayer. Have they always loved it? No. Have you always loved it? Most probably not. If we're honest, how many can be honest and say, your worst memory is of a prayer meeting? If I'm honest, many of my endurance challenges when my dad's beady eye says, don't you dare, Rachel, was in a prayer meeting. But thank God prayer meetings have changed somewhat. We've begun to find a new fluency. We've begun to find a new breadth and depth. We've begun to understand that Jesus loves the expression of the heart. Yes. And all over the world today, would you agree with me, there's a cry, now is the time to pray. For those of you who are here this afternoon, I recognise some of your faces. You saw a prayer meeting. Helen shared some slides of 70,000 people gathering together in Cairo in the open air, defying all the authorities, risking imprisonment because they knew that this is a shifting time for their nation and they could not do anything better than stand and pray. And so, I don't know what motivates you to prayer. I hope it isn't just crisis. Unfortunately, too often in our life, it is the crisis that motivates us. Yeah. It is the telephone call, so-and-so's got cancer, or so-and-so's lost their job, or so-and-so, how many of you know what I'm talking about? And then we think, oh, I need to pray. But I hope that actually we are more mature lovers of Jesus then it's just crisis that motivates us to talk. How many of you hate those sort of friends. Or maybe I shouldn't say that, because of course we're Christians, we never hate anyone. But I mean, you have certain people that when you see them coming up the path, you think, what do they want? Because the only time you really have a conversation with them is when they want something from you. And you're not really sure if you have a relationship where they like you, they actually like what you can do for them. How many know what I'm talking about? I think as life goes on, you begin to discover that. Put it this way, in John chapter 15, verse 15, Jesus says to us, I want you as my friend. I no longer call you a servant, I now call you friends. Sorry, I've realised I've got the PowerPoint for Paul Heaven. She's got to guess. No, you should have great word of what, wisdom, knowledge, revelation. Just know when to flip it.
I'm praying for it.
Well, my word of wisdom was it would help her if she had a copy of it. And I haven't put the scripture here, but as I'm just standing here, I just feel John 15, 15, it says, I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I've called you friends. And everything I've learned from the Father, I want to make known to you. I just want you to think for a little moment. How much do you think Jesus knew from the Father? Everything? Do you think that's a sizable download? Yeah. Everything of the Father was made known to Jesus. And Jesus says, I want to make that known to you. How many know that's a download? And Jesus says, I want to have friendship. How many of you know that if you want to exchange communication, you've got to give it time? If you carry on reading in John 16, verse 12, it says, I have so much more to say to you, more than I can bear. But when he, the Spirit of truth, comes, he will guide you into all truth. He will not speak on his own. He will only speak what he hears, and he will tell you what is yet to come. He will bring glory to me, who's speaking, Jesus. Who is he? Holy Spirit. So if I put that in, Holy Spirit will bring glory to Jesus by taking what belongs to Jesus and making it known to you. And then verse 15 of John 16 says, all that belongs to the Father belongs to me. So that is a complete download. All that belongs to the Father belongs to Jesus. And that is why Jesus said, the Spirit will take what is mine, belongs to Jesus, and make it known to you. Isn't that phenomenal?
Yeah.
That is prayer. You can go home. But do you understand what I'm saying? That is prayer. Prayer is not so much about crisis. Prayer is not so much about saying, oh God, help me, help me. Prayer is about a relationship of a friendship. I no longer call you servants. In other words, change the duty mentality. I'm now a Christian. I've got to pray. I've got to do. I don't want you having a duty mentality of ticking a box that I now have to pray. I want you to have friendship mentality that I can share my life with you. And how many of you know, if you give people time, you get to know them better?
That's right.
I've just watched my son fall in love, get married. And the things my son did were quite amazing. Helen's laughing because he even came home. And I mean, my son's a big guy, rugby. He went to Loughborough University and played rugby and hockey. So he's sports boy, he's fit, he's in the gym. He came home and said, Mum, you're going to India, aren't you? And I said, yes. He said, could you buy me some material? Now, when your son starts asking for material, it gets a bit strange. Then he comes home and I go to India, get this material all specified. And he says, can you get the sewing machine out and teach me to sew? Helen was there and she says, what's going on? I said, this is called love. Love, second thing. And he personally handmade and sewed a stocking for Jenny for Christmas. All handmade and designed. How sweet. The things love makes a guy do. Quite extraordinary. I want to ask you, what does your passion passion and love for Jesus make you do? Will it break some sound barriers? Yes. Will it put you in places where anyone else watching is, you're being a bit strange. What's up with you? I'm in love. I have to talk. I have to get to know him more. I want more of his face. I want more of his time. I want to know the very secrets of God. I want to ask you, will you go digging? Increased prayer will always bring increased revelation. Do you agree?
Yes.
Come home. If you see, if you talk to God more, God will talk to you more. That's basic. And so when I talk to God, it's prayer. When God talks to me, we call it revelation. But it is a two-way conversation. And so many people say, thank you, I don't know what to do. Will you pray for me? Mm-hmm. Will you think, actually, the best thing you can do is pray for yourself. I'm not being rude, but actually, if you begin to learn the sound of God, you'll have more confidence with your direction, more security in your life, more things. We just need to be talkers. You know, maybe BT got it right. It's time to talk. So turn to your friends, it's time to talk.
Time to talk.
So, next one, please. I'm going to move on. Luke 11, verse 1. Read it from the screen with me if you can. One day, Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. I want you to imagine for a moment, if Jesus came into the room and you could have one thing taught by the master, what would it be? I'm not sure what I would have chosen if I would have chosen prayer. I think I would really like to have learned to raise the dead. You know, that would have seemed very spectacular. The amazing thing was, the disciples did go on to do many mighty signs, wonders, and miracles. But they watched the life of Jesus, and as they watched him praying in a certain place, something was provoked. A hunger was stirred, and they grasped hold of Jesus. Jesus, teach me to pray. And I would just like to start, and maybe that seems ever so simple, but I think the first place of developing a life of prayer is stirring that cry that says, oh God, teach me to pray. Oh Jesus, teach me to pray. How many of you could do with an upgrade and a lesson? Oh Jesus, just teach me my language. Teach me how to pray. Stir in me a passion for you. But help me be a good friend, not just a crisis friend, that every time something's wrong, I'm knocking on the door saying, oh God, help me, like our friend we were just talking about, that only appears when they need something, and then you never see them. God, I don't want to be that sort of friend to you. That the only time you get any conversation with me is when I'm in trouble. And the rest of the time it's like, bye God, I'll see you later, but I'm fine now, I can sort my life. God loves you. We need to hear that cry of God from the Garden of Eden in Genesis chapter 3, verse 9. Remember when Adam hid himself in the garden and God comes down into the garden to walk and he cries, Adam, where are you? I don't believe that was a cry of anger. Adam, where are you? Get here, boy. I believe there was a heart cry from God. I've lost my friend. Every evening I came down into the garden and I walked with my friend and I talked with my friend. And now sin has got in the way and I've lost my friend. Adam, where are you? And Adam comes out from behind the tree and it says, I hid because I was afraid. And so you see, the first thing I believe if we're really going to grasp a prayer life is we've got to deal with negative mindsets. Right at the very beginning in the Garden of Eden, Genesis chapter 3 verse 9, we see that Adam hid. When sin entered that garden, he hid because he was afraid. What was he afraid of? I can't talk to God anymore. I'm dirty. He covered himself with fig leaves. I don't feel worthy. Who am I? How can I connect with God? How many of you feel your prayer life is not up to scratch? It's fine. I want to say, if we had the courage to all look around, it's not the article, most of us were saying, why do we all feel that? Because you see, there's the same enemy, the same devil, who wants to shut communication down. For what were you created? You were created to talk to God. What delights the heart of God? That you will talk to him, that there is friendship. What does the devil hate? The fact that mankind is made for God and God is made for mankind. What did sin come? To break that relationship. Why do we all live under this fear, insecurity, condemnation, sense of failure, my prayer's not good enough? Because it's the enemy's plan to break what God always intended, that we would bring pleasure to our daddy heart of the Father. And so as soon as sin enters the garden, what enters? Fear. Yeah. Adam has. I'm afraid, can't pray, can't do this, can't talk. And I believe the first thing we have to do to grasp a prayer life is break the fear. And begin to be simple enough to believe, my Father in heaven loves my voice. He wants to talk with me. He wants to meet with me. For too long, we've had stereotypes in our minds about prayer and how we can pray. It's my place of failure. I never do it enough. If only Rachel would pray for me, then it would happen. No, I want to say, I can't pray for your need. The best person to pray for it is you, or I can partner with it. I mean, Galatians 6:1 does say, carry one another's burdens. But don't ask someone to carry it because of the sense of guilt or inadequacy of your own. And so often we think, if I could just give it away, they would break it through. No. You have authority to stand for your family, for your children, for your needs. Daddy wants to hear your voice. Let me hear your voice. For your voice is sweet and your face is lovely, as Song of Songs said. Don't let shame hide you. The other thing that the enemy has convinced us of, or maybe church sometimes is convinced of, is prayer is just boring. But let's break that once and for all. Yeah. There is nothing boring about having a real relationship and a real conversation with God. Mm-hmm. So we've got to deal with those negative attitudes that we've absorbed, sometimes without even realizing it. And say, no, I'm going to be someone who's passionate for prayer. Then the second thing I think is we begin to develop a praying life is we need to recognize our season. What do I mean by that? Recognize our time and season. There's some dear people, like I had a young mum come to me. She'd just given birth. She got 3 children under 5 and her baby was about 11, 12 weeks. And she came to me and she was in church and they were all dressed and everything. She said, oh, I'm so exhausted and I feel so guilty even being here. I've hardly had time to pray. I said, sweetie, the fact you're all dressed and your kids are here is a miracle. You deserve applause, not condemnation. And I'm sure many of you can remember those days when you're juggling everything. And you see, in certain seasons, and then she looked at me, she said, yeah, but I used to spend an hour reading and I used to pray like this. I said, yeah, but that was a used to. Because then you had time at those times. I said, what time did you get up this morning? She said, well, at 6. I said, yeah. And did you get up at 3? She said, yeah. And did you get to bed at 12? Yeah. I said, look, you've been up all night, sweet. Do you understand what I'm saying? And so often we remember these seasons, which were maybe supernatural seasons where God graced us for a real intimate conversation, but you can't live like that for the rest of your life. And it's like then the devil comes in and says, oh, but when you were really passionate for God, you used to pray 3 hours in the morning or 1 hour at night, or you pray for an hour in the car, or you do this, and now you just fall to sleep as soon as you get into bed and you don't pray properly. How many have had those sort of things? It's like, you know, if you were really walking with God, you would still be doing. I want to say, recognize the times and seasons. Recognize, I mean, I don't mean to be rude, but many of you are older. You know, recognise as you get older, your seasons. How many of you notice your seasons have changed? If it's changed in every other area of life, be kind to yourself. It's going to change in your spiritual conversation. The way you talk to God at 6 is going to be different than 26 and different than at 60. Determine and make a real assessment with God. You see, the Holy Spirit is a responsible spirit. And so go to God and ask him, Father, what season, what time do you want from me in this season of my life? You know, a young mum, quite often, even to go to the bathroom is a privilege. And if you can do that on your own, you're lucky. So how do you find time to pray? Well, you grab the 5 minutes and get rid of the idea, I've got to find 5 hours. As you get older, you have to find the time. Maybe the routine of last thing at night, which you've had in your teenage children years, isn't the time anymore because you fall to sleep. I've discovered, and maybe this horrifies you, but I was never a person to get up early to pray. I'm a disaster early in the morning. My husband, he's British Army military trained. He's up like a button, 6 o'clock, he's ready to put the world to right. I am not. And so when we got married, I felt incredibly guilty, because here's my husband, he'll be up 5:30, by 6 o'clock, he will pray, read his Bible, he's read the whole of the Bible by the time I found coffee. You know, I always felt I'm no good. But I discovered, once my kids were at school and I got the dog, I could walk and pray. I could walk with my dog, but then I always had this guilt. Oh, it's not spiritual to walk and pray with your dog. It has to sit in the chair. I mean, crazy stuff. Maybe you never think like that, but how many of you do think like that? Thank you. I'm not this man. But you see, we've got to find our times, rhythms and seasons. Yes. I've found musicians who've come to me and said, I just can't pray. I just never pray. But then I hear them play their instrument, and to me, that's a prayer. And I said, well, do you pray but with when you play? Oh, no, but you have to sit and pray. I said, who made this rule? You have to sit in a chair, keep your eyes open, and sit quiet with the door shut. Why is that the only posture of prayer? I said, sit at your keyboards. Begin to play. And this particular young man, Paul his name was, he said, that just transformed his life. He said he would get up in the morning, go down to his keyboards, begin to play, and his heart would begin to talk. Yeah. And he would play so much of his prayer through his keyboard. He began to write some fabulous songs and music. But that was his prayer. And I'm sure David, the psalmist, who we all love, we love his prayers. I wonder how many of those were written while his fingers were on the lyre or the harp or an instrument. You see, what I want to do is try and break you out of some of your formula for prayer. So identify your times and seasons. Ask God to show you what is the time for you. And then also identify the way in which you're going to pray. Because some people, again, the classic thing with prayer, Rachel, do you believe prayer is a lifestyle and you should just walk and talk and pray? Or Rachel, do you believe you should go into a room and shut the door and have intimate time when you're devoted to God? Which is real prayer? Both. Both. Am I just trying to dodge the issue? No, because I believe both are communication. I believe that there is a legitimate walk and talk prayer through the whole of your life. That's the praying you can do when you're driving, where you don't close your eyes, please. Where you just, in your heart, you've got your heart open, and you're just talking. Something like, oh God, find me a parking space. And, oh God, direct my day. God, really help me. God, I've got so much. Just be with me today. As I see so-and-so, I just pray you'll give me wisdom. How many of you have those sorts of prayers? It's just thoughts going through your life. That is a living relationship with a friend where you are talking, communicating. That is absolutely valid prayer. I've been married to my husband for 30 years. And there's, how many of you would say, in marriage there's a lot of conversation which doesn't sound deeply affectionate and loving, but is absolutely necessary for a relationship. Like, if I hadn't had the conversation with my husband, sweetie, I'm going up to Felixstowe. I'm not going to be home when you get in from your meeting tonight. I'm going to be away. And I'll be sleeping over there. How do you know that could cause great tension in our marriage if I never bothered to tell him where I was? And it might seem very administrative, but I believe a lot of our administrative every day, God, I'm just thinking about this. That's how you develop friendship. But if that was the only relationship that I had, or only communication, how do you know that's shallow? Yeah. February the 14th, just in case you hadn't noticed, is coming up. And, you know, there are certain days where we're almost commanded these days. You will have that intimate table for two. Maybe you react to it. But there are those times in every good relationship where hopefully someone, your husband, like I'm married to a minister, we live in Oxford, and I know if Gordon comes in, leaves the cell phone, mobile phone on the countertop, and says, come on, sweetie, we're going out, and drives out of Oxford, then we're really going to be able to talk. Why do I say that? Because if we're in Oxford, they all know us. Any coffee, any cafe, too many students, he'll go, oh, Gordon, Gordon, and thing. But if he leaves his cell phone, I know I've got his attention. If we leave town, I really am going to have a night with my man, and I can talk at a different level because I know we won't be interrupted. How many know what I'm talking about? You see, that's why we have those seasons of prayer where we shut the door. It's not because that's the real prayer. That's because it actually stops all the distractions so that you can pray at a different level. I want to ask you, when's the last time, and I don't mean this irreverently, but you made a date with God? It's like, this is God's time. Nothing else is going to invade it. I just want to talk to him. And it's not crisis motivated, it's thus, I want to be God's friend. You'll be amazed, as you make that part of your communication life, it will put a whole new depth into your life. You'll begin to know that voice of God. And many of us, myself included, when I used to begin, are terrified. I remember I had a wonderful mentor called Thelma Sparks when I was about 17, 18 years old. And she used to go away for retreat days. It sounded a bit like becoming a nun. And I was always very worried what she actually did. Until one day she said, would you like to come on retreat? So I sort of said, all right. We went to this beautiful house with great grounds. And so I said, well, what do you do? She said, well, you take your Bible. And she said, I'm going to just go and walk for 3 hours. And God's going to speak to me. I was absolutely terrified. I'd never really prayed for more than about 3 minutes in a prayer meeting and listened to everyone else pray for 3 hours. And so it was like, how do you just go walk and God talks? But actually, we went away for those 3 days and I found a rhythm. It took me time to disconnect, to stop getting distracted. And I just find I'm one of those maybe slightly control freak, bit J, keep it in order, like my list, tick the box. If you're like that, just do your list, get it off the charts. You know, there's nothing worse for me than trying to sit there and think, I mustn't think about that, I'm meant to be praying. I shouldn't be remembering about the jack. I shouldn't think, no, just write the list. Because we go through all sorts of super spiritual hurdles, but in the end up just messing the time. Just be practical. How many of you believe Jesus and God is really, really practical? They love us. But he knows that I'm one of these people who go, God, I'm going to forget this, I'm going to forget this. He knows. Go on, Rachel, just do it. Come back. Thank you, Rachel. Now, can I have your attention? I mean, if my dear husband understands it, surely God does. How many of you understand what I'm saying today? It's about developing a friendship. So I want to just look at how do you breathe creativity into your house of prayer? How do you breathe creativity into your house of prayer? The Bible uses that language again and again about build me a house of prayer. And often we think of it just in the church context. But I want to say to you, how many know this temple is to be a house of prayer? How many of you have redecorated or remodeled your house in the last 40 years? I'm very grateful. But you see, sometimes we get saved. How many of you have known Jesus for more than 10 years? More than 20 years? More than 30 years? You see, a lot of you know Jesus a long time. How many of you have radically changed the way you pray in that time? Good. And often people say, oh, why have you done that? Well, the reason is because we're rebuilding a house of prayer. Just as we do in the natural, we remodel it, so we need to rebuild, put creativity. And most of us, however much we like to say we're funky, cutting edge, whatever, we have our normal little route. How many of you usually enter your house the same way every time? Although you've got more than one door to enter your house. We just do.
Yeah.
I very, very rarely use my front door. I always use my side door. Why? Because I'm lazy. It's the nearest one to the garage, so I just use that one. And very quickly, any friend notices, don't use the front door. Rachel doesn't know what the front door is for. She always goes to the back door and says, oh, where are you? What are you doing around there? And we can be like that with God. We always enter our house of prayer the same way. So when someone says, pray, it's like we open our mouth, and if we're used to praying in the Spirit, we just pray in the Spirit. Well, why don't you ever pray with understanding? Oh, well, that's just the door I always use. Or someone says, pray, you immediately are the sort of person who prays asking prayers. God, we just need this, we need this. Is it wrong? No, but it's just that's become your format of communication. But is that the only door you're ever going to enter the house of prayer? I will enter his courts with thanksgiving in my heart. I enter his gates of praise. What about that gate? When's the last time you just always entered with, God, it's so great to be in your presence. I love you so much. God, I've had the most fantastic day. I'm just so grateful for your presence with me. I didn't know how I was going to cope with today, but you've been with me. I'm so grateful. What about that entrance of a prayer? Because we can get stuck, especially the season's hard of, oh God, oh God, oh God. So I want to ask you, I want you just to think for a moment. You've got a house of prayer. You can think of it a bit like a doll's house, I don't know. You can think of it any house. But this is the house of prayer. How are you going to build a house of communication with the incredible God? What is going to be part of that language, that fluency? Because prayer is much more than just saying, Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. How many would agree with me? That can be a good skeleton or coat rack. But it's more than that. He wants to hear your sound through it. So, as you begin to build this house of prayer, and this applies for your personal life, right up to your corporate life, church life, etc., why don't you think about the position of prayer? How many of you know, before you even think about what you're saying, why don't we just read those through? Just and then think about it. Kneeling, standing, prostrating, driving, sleeping, hopefully not at the same time, near the sea, sitting, walking, inside or outside, in the shower, near water, on the mountains. Why have I thrown up all sorts of things you can most probably add lots? How many more? No. Immediately look at those positions, you would pray differently.
Yeah.
How many of you find if you pray inside, you pray differently than when you pray outside?
Yeah.
I find I do. And I often need to pray outside when I can't find fluency. If I'm inside and I just can't begin to pray, it's amazing if I just go outside, take the dog, or just even walk, if I haven't got the dog, I can begin to pray. How many of you find that? Just change of just geography will change. Yeah. How many of you, I mean, you're near the sea. Come on, how many of you find if you walk near the sea, that helps you? How many of you found mountains or that sort of thing? How many of you find you pray different on holiday when you go away? Why? Because there's something in us, I believe, because we are created, But when we're with the creation and there's a different creation, it triggers different language. Because we're fearfully, wonderfully made. And begin to connect into all of that of, wow, God, when I'm here, I feel this. That's part of the very nature of who you are. God, this is fantastic. How many of you know when you kneel, you pray differently than when you stand? There's times to bow down. God, I'm just in such awe of you. There's times you want to kneel. It's funny, I went through a season of my life when I knelt by my bed. And that wasn't when I was 10. That was when I was in my 30s. And it's just like, I'm bowing before you, God. This is out of my hands. I can't actually do this. But I bow before a most incredible God. And I felt it was a season when a lot of responsibility was being put on me. Lots of demands were on me. I felt so little. And I just kept feeling, God, I can't do all of this. I haven't got a clue what I'm doing. I feel like I'm flying by the seat of my pants. But oh, I bow before an incredible God. And I'm so glad that you can help me. And it was interesting because I didn't even notice what I was doing, but I just used to find myself, and I often by my sofa, I would start sitting on my sofa, and I'd turn around and I'd kneel and I'd just take the cushion and put my head down, or do it by my bed. How many of you ever had those sort of experiences? You see, it's important, the very position. I want to sort of help you identify, oh, this is that. That's why I'm doing it. It's so important. There's other times you should stand. How many of you know? You don't feel like it, but it's like, I need to stand up and take authority. This is enough now. I'm just going to walk. And you can stomp your feet, walk up and down. I learned that going to Africa. We were missionaries in Africa. How many of you have been to prayer meetings with precious Africans in? How many of you know they're not quiet?
Yes.
How many know they're wonderful? There is something that they stand up. They taught me to warfare. They taught me to say, no, it's enough now in Jesus' name. I just come against every pressure of oppression and depression. I just thank you, Father, that you are with me. And you see, you can sit down and think, oh God, I feel so awful. I'm feeling sick. Everything's going wrong. And they taught me, no, stand. Stand up. There's a time to stand.
Yeah.
And so, Father, I just thank you today that sickness is not going to come near our home. Father, I just thank you for your healing power coming through my body right now. I want to break the curse of everything. Africa taught me to take authority, be more direct. And then, you know, I would come home and feel sorry for myself. And I feel God saying, get up, girl. Stop moaning. And there's times when we can feel sorry. Oh, the people knew all that was going on, and now this has happened, that's happened, and now the washing machine's broken. And it's like, get up, God. Speak to yourself. Stand. Yeah. Different positions. So I want you to think, in your private life, in your personal life, and sometimes we're terribly private, we get embarrassed. I remember there was a baby Christian in our church, wonderful girl, radically come through to Jesus. And I went round to her house one day because she'd been asking me all sorts of questions and I said I'd come and see her. I got there, and a little face, her eyes were like, sources like, oh no. And I said, sweetie, I don't have to come now. And I could see she was a bit embarrassed. She said, oh well, do you mind just sitting in your car for 10 minutes and I'll be with you? I said, no, not at all. And then I came in and finally she said, oh, well, I suppose I'll tell you. She said, I moved all the furniture around in my lounge to give myself space. Because when I prayed this morning, I thought, I've got to begin to dance. So I said, why? She said, because I've noticed some people in church, when they're so full of joy, they begin to dance before God. And she said, I didn't know how you did that. So she thought, I'd come home and I'd put my CD on and I'd ask God to teach me how to have a spirit of joy. So I've been practicing how to pray with joy. I thought, I love that. So maybe some of you need to do something extraordinary at home and then you can, no. But positions of prayer. I mentioned prayer retreats already. But maybe you need to think of some time of really putting some fluency. So what is the language of prayer? I'm going to touch a few things. How do we pray? What's the expression of prayer? What do we say? Although I'm going to give many sorts of sounds, I want to say that I really believe that there is no perfect prayer, but there is a perfect prayer for you in each season. Why do I say that? Because you see, God just loves communication. And there are principles that can help you pray, but in the end, your heartfelt expression to God is always the perfect prayer. And we can so often be intimidated by other people's fluency, but it isn't about the professional language so much as the heart cry of relationship. And so, although we hear some sounds of prayer, these, if you like, are your artist's palette of different colours, different sounds that are in the scripture, that is the way God likes to talk. And he says, come on, increase your vocabulary, increase your fluency. So number one I put, and these are not in any order of priority particularly, they're just in an order of how I found them, I think, to be perfectly honest. Supplication. We often hear that word, supplicative prayer. We think, I don't know if I ever do that. What is supplicative prayer? Well, prayer is, it is the prayer that I expect most of us to cry and pray. Oh, help. How many know that one? God, I need help. God, give me strength. God, give me grace. Supplicative prayer is the prayer that appeals. It's got a strong appeal in it. You read it in Habakkuk chapter 3, verse 2. Oh God, in wrath, remember mercy. It has a strong cry of appeal. In fact, if you look at the Psalms, again and again, much of David's prayers starts from a supplicative praise. Oh God, rescue me. Oh God, help me. Oh God, lift me up. Oh God, oh God. The supplicative prayer tends to have that tone to it. Oh God, oh God, oh God. It's like when I haven't got a lot of strength within myself, but oh God, how I need you. It has a quality of strong urgency. It usually comes with a deep sense of entreaty. God, I know I don't deserve it, but oh God, please help me. How many of you know what I'm talking about? And it usually has a strong cry of favor. Oh God, bless me, help me, strengthen me, show me kindness. So that's supplicative prayer. God, help me. One commentator or commentary that I read, which I loved, he said, to him, a dog sitting with his eyes focused on your chocolate biscuit is the best expression of supplicative prayer. That pleading, I'm being a good boy, please give me some biscuit. But that's the sense that we're looking into the face of Father. So say, I know I don't deserve this, but please help me. I really would like that. Supplicative prayer. Help me, Jesus. I need help. Number two, asking or petitioning. We often use the word petitioning. I put asking, because basically it is the simple asking prayer. It's a prayer that asks for a need. We see it in Matthew 7:7. Ask and you'll receive. Next layer.
Seek
and you will
find.
Next layer.
Knock.
It will be opened. Can you see three layers? Ask, a bit more casual. Ask, you'll receive. Seek, intently look. Get a bit more focus. I'm seeking. You'll receive. Knock. Get persistent. God, I'm not going. I'm knocking on this door of heaven. It will open.
Yes.
Three different layers. Ask. Psalm 2, verse 8, what does it say? Ask of me and I will give you the
nations
as your inheritance. So you can ask from a car parking place up to a nation. Isn't that amazing? Simple asking, petitioning prayer. How many of you have discovered if you ask God for a nation, suddenly he puts a passion on you, and what you asked for casually in the beginning, you begin to seek for,
yes.
And then you begin knocking and doors open.
Mm.
I find often asking, petitioning prayer starts as maybe more casual, but then God grips you, engages you in conversation, and you find more and more it opens to a deeper prayer.
Mm.
Ask me for Felixstowe. Ask me for your neighbour. Ask me for a friend.
Mm.
And suddenly you find you're seeking him for him. You're knocking on the door. So it's a simple prayer. Why do I think asking prayer is so important? I believe because it's that everyday walking relationship. It just shows that dependency in Jesus. That's why I believe it's important to ask from Syria to that parking place. Oh God, help me that I don't slip on the ice. You know, the simple asking prayers. I believe in prayer. How many of you believe in prayer? Just keep him included. Ask him prayer. Next one, intercession. Intercession. What is intercession? What do we think intercession is?
Prayer for other people.
That's exactly what I usually say. It's prayer that represents another's need before God. It's the prayer that stands in the gap. It's the prayer that looks beyond your own need and stretches out. Because you see, if your prayer is only self-centered, then it's become very restricted. So we need to stretch our prayer. Yes, me, mine, and I, what I need. God says, bring your requests, bring your needs, very valid. But if it gets stuck there, your prayer life has got stuck. So press out. Where are you stretching out to? Where are you standing in the gap? Who are you praying for that, in a sense, it isn't an immediate benefit to yourself, but you are being generous? The other thing I call intercession is the prayer of generosity. It's the prayer you give away. So how generous are you in prayer? God, I'm going to give prayer away. I'm going to give it away to other people's children. You know, we always have that choice. You can be irritated, or you can be irritated to pray. God, I want to pray for them. God, I want to pray you'll keep them. I tell you, so often when I see these guys on their motorbikes whizzing past, the first thing I just say, oh God, that's someone's son.
Yeah.
God, keep them. Pray that they're not going to end up with a funeral.
Yeah.
And maybe you think that's crazy, but I'm going to be generous for prayer. I'm going to pray for them. But also there's the specific prayer, standing in the gap for nations and times. And number four, thanksgiving. Thanksgiving. Supplication, the prayer of appeal, asking, the simple prayer, intercession, the prayer of generosity, thanksgiving. How many of you find the thanksgiving prayer easy? Yeah, interesting. I would have thought that I should and would. But it was really interesting. One day God really spoke to me and said to me, Rachel, your thanksgiving prayer is very stereotyped. You need a new fluency.
Mm.
And I began to realize that when I prayed the thank you prayer, it was like, God, I really thank you for Gordon. Thank you for my great kids. Thank you for this. But it was very like ABC. I had no fluency. I had no real revelation in my life at that time of how grateful I should be for the goodness of God.
Mm.
That I love to worship, but I didn't have very good language for it.
Mm.
And God said to me quite clearly, he said, Rachel, for 3 weeks, I want to put you on a thank you diet. In other words, when you come into the house of prayer, come in with an attitude of gratitude. Come in saying thank you. And I began to discover, actually, there's so much we can be grateful for. I began to discover, actually, I didn't have a very wide, grateful vocabulary. The other thing, just because I mean, each of these I can basically preach for half an hour. I love the subject of prayer. But the other thing, especially for parents that are here, grandparents, when our kids come, is if you think the Thanksgiving prayer is mostly the prayer we model most in front of our children, in the sense of grace, you know, breakfast, lunch, and tea. Most families still have the tradition of saying, let's say thank you for the food. But actually, as a model of prayer, it's usually one of the worst. do you understand what I'm saying? In thinking of prayer in this context, on the other hand, please don't exasperate your children by letting them die of hunger while you pray around the whole world. Because as a child of ministers, that is really annoying as well. But somehow, we've got to find a way that we don't just make our grace like a nursery rhyme. Because it can almost become a Humpty Dumpty sat in the wall, Humpty Dumpty fell in the wall, amen, let's eat. And no one would hardly notice that's what we said, unless they suddenly go, do you really say that? I actually tried it in my house once and I nearly got away with it. Because you see, we have just a phrase and a sort of routine of how it goes up and down, but we're not engaged. And true prayer, especially prayer of thanksgiving, surely should be body, soul, mind, heart, being. There should be a yay God in it. I'm so grateful. I'm so happy. And in some senses, if we can't really say, wow, what an incredible privilege of having food. What incredible. It doesn't have to get over sentimental, cringy. But somehow, and this is why God put me on a thank you diet, I realised I've lost the sense of gratitude for how many incredible things I had. And it's all like, thanks for the food I'm in. Okay, eat up. Don't let it get cold. And it's almost like in the same sentence. Somehow, I needed a moment to begin to ponder, saying, wow, what a privilege. What an incredible privilege. God, I might even say the same thing, but hopefully from a different place. God, teach me to really be grateful. So, four prayers. Four more prayers. These are slightly different. What about the prayer of confession? The prayer that says, I'm sorry. Quite often we think, oh, well, that's what the Catholics do. Thank God we're not Catholics. We don't have to have a confessional. Excuse me, how many people have sinned since they were saved? It's a good idea if we confess it before we get to heaven. Because our Bible actually says, confess your sins. And there's something, you know, I believe many, many Christians walk around with an incredible sense of guilt and shame because we haven't really learnt the prayer of confession. Mm. Obviously, we don't have to go to priests. We can come to Jesus and say, Father, I really messed up today. Please forgive me. I'm sorry. And we need to put our hands up and say, I'm guilty. Not, well, God, if that idiot hadn't reversed out like that, I wouldn't have lost my temper. We actually need to say, I'm sorry, I lost my temper. Hands up, please forgive me. Don't shift the blame. And if we would become very good at quickly praying the prayer of I'm sorry, many marriages would be happier. Many houses would be happier, workplaces would be happier, and life might be a little less stressful. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you, how often do you knock at that door? I'm sorry. I'm sorry. I wasn't very good at that prayer either, but I've learned it. I remember my son, he's a great boy, I remember him looking quizzically at me one day, I can't remember how old he was, I think about 9-ish, looked and said, Mummy, how come when I'm cross, I always have to say sorry? When you're cross with Daddy, you don't. I love children. How come? God, I'm sorry. I'm sorry when I get angry. I'm sorry when I get resentful. I'm sorry for those things that go with him. Lord, forgive me. We need to pray. Number 6, the other one, prayer of forgiveness. How quickly do you pray, yes, I forgive you. I forgive you. I forgive you. Again, if we prayed that prayer quickly, marriages, houses, work, churches, community would be a lot happier. We often, maybe we don't think of them as powerful prayers, but how many of you know that prayer, I forgive you? Simple, short, very powerful. And again here, there's almost different levels. You know, like someone can walk in, drop a cup of orange juice. It's an irritation. They say, I'm really sorry. We can genuinely say, I forgive you, hopefully. And then there's what I call those maybe your £5 blemishes. And they're quick, you know, it's like, I can forgive the £5 error. Got grace for that. Often then we find maybe the 50,000 errors, we just know we've got no capacity to even go near it. So usually we come to God and we get healed. I'm thinking of things like maybe someone abused you when you were younger. Maybe someone really betrayed you. Someone stole an inheritance. You know, the major stuff which needs massive grace, supernatural forgiveness. Usually we're better at praying for, I forgive you, because we suddenly recognise this is a biggie and if I don't deal with it, I'm bitter for the rest of my life. How many know what I'm talking about? And so we tend to deal with the £5 one and the 50,000 one. The ones we're not so good at are what I call our £500 one. It's enough to really annoy us, but it's not so big that we think it's going to destroy us. It's like the one, let me give this as an illustration, and it's not prophesying, so don't worry, that you go out to the car park to get to your car and you find that someone's hit it in the door. You think, I can't believe I parked my car in the church car park, someone's pinged my car and they can't even tell me. And it niggles you. Something more like that. How many of you know what I'm talking about? It's got a little bit of weight to it. But it's not huge. And those are the ones which are. Someone says to you, did you know so-and-so said this about you, or this has happened or something? And you get a little bit of gospel thing, and you suddenly think, right, I can sort that. And then you think, ah. Next time you see them, you think, yeah, I should just forgive it and get on. But you think, no, I'll hold it. How many know what I'm talking about? Those are the ones that are the killers that we have to generously pray, I forgive you. I want to ask you, will you really build your house with a lot of I forgive you in it? Number 7, prayer of proclamation. I don't know if you've noticed, but when you read the Bible, the fascinating thing about the Bible is that Jesus did a lot of praying in a secret place and we don't know what he said. When Jesus came out of that place, his prayers were very short, sweet, and authoritative. Come out, be strong, be opened, silence, shut up to the storm, cease, get up and walk. Very authoritative, short, direct. Very proclamative. All his public prayer. And he prayed for the man, be opened. Didn't say, Father, I'm, you know, you don't have a long prayer of the pastoral sound that maybe we would be more used to. Father, really bless him. So sorry that he's been blind. Father, you know the hardship he's been through, but just touch his eye. There's no pastoral sound in any of the prayers of Jesus' public prayer. Be open, come here. And I think there's a proclamative prayer, and I hinted at it already talking about Africa, that quite often in our British culture we go, that's a bit scary. You know, why are they shouting at God? God's not deaf, you don't have to shout. But you know, sometimes it is that sound of authority, of body, soul, mind, spirit, being, coming into alignment, saying, let it be in Jesus' name. And it's not actually about the sound, it's about an authority thing. Sure. And you sort of, you do it and you go, oh, what was that about? How many of you found that there have been times of prayer, you lift your voice and you suddenly go, oh, why did I shout? How many of you experienced that? Well, I believe it's that prayer of declaration, that prayer of proclamation. It's actually not now speaking to God, but it's speaking to the heavens above, the earth beneath, and all who live in the land. It's actually a declaration out from God, rather than a prayer to God. And it's a different prayer. But I believe God wants to put that prayer on his church again, that we speak to this mountain, we speak to the blind eyes. And I've often found it's in the more healing and the contemplative where you suddenly find, no, in Jesus' name. How many of you ever felt that intensity? You've seen something, and something stands up, say, no, it's enough now. And a warfare spirit comes, and no longer are you praying to God, you are now speaking speaking to the situation as a representative from God. And that's a different prayer, but I believe it's a prayer the British church needs to find, because we need to execute our authority. Mm. There are times, I did it with both my kids at different times. Fortunately, none of them really walked away from God hard, but they were, both of them had wobbles at different periods of their life. And I remember walking up to my son's bedroom, walking in, I did not give birth to my son for the devil. I gave birth to him for the kingdom of God. No, get off his life. And I frightened myself. But there was something of the mama spirit rose up and said, it's enough now, no. I prayed with the tears towards God, but something had rose up on the line against the face of the enemy. Lion and lamb.
Yeah.
Proclamation. Silence. Mm. Often we're really scared of the silence. Mm. Yeah. So why don't we just close our eyes for a moment? I want you to think a part of the nature of God. We already shouted it. Jesus is. Mm. But why don't you just meditate on it? Think of something. Look at that face of your father, the friend. Mm. Say, oh God, I thank you.
Thank you, Father.
So come, Holy Spirit. We love you so much. We love you. Amen. Then on the last slide, and I'm just literally going to read them because they're pretty self-explanatory. I just want to challenge you to decorate your house of prayer beyond words. There's the prayer of the Holy Spirit. Jude 20.
When you pray, build yourself up. You raise heavy faith, pray in the Spirit. And so often there's times when we have to go beyond our conscious understanding and let the power of the Holy Spirit pray through us. There's a prayer of fasting. Why do we pray and fast? What is the language? What's the communication of fasting with prayer? I believe it's that atmosphere of sacrifice. When we put sacrifice with our prayer, it puts another sound level in our prayer. It's that dying to myself connecting. And you see, sacrifice has got a strong language. How many of you know that? And so it's beyond our words. And that's why there's times when you just know, I need to sacrifice something. Because I want God really to know, God, this is all about you. I'm ready to sacrifice something that's pushing me because I want you to hear my cry. Sacrifice puts another sound in your prayer. Number 11. What about written prayers? Not all prayers have to be spoken. How many of you have taken time to write a prayer? You know, sometimes when you just have almost, I've sometimes done this pastorally with people who've just lost someone, or they've lost a wife, or especially if they've lost a child, actually. There's times when you're almost so traumatized, you don't know what to say. I often say to them, well, don't try and say anything to God. See if you can write it. How many of you know writing is a different language? How many of you are glad that David wrote some prayers? How many times have you just opened it and thought, wow? The other thing I've done with written prayers, just something I've done, my husband is quite poetical, and he's written poems for my kids at various times. I'm not a poet. I can't do that. But when both my children came to 18, I wrote them a prayer. I said, this is the prayer that I want to declare over you as you enter as a man, as you enter as a woman. And I did the same for them when they got married. And I just wrote that mother's prayer. I said, this is the cry of a mother. For their 18, I wrote it much more about, I want to celebrate and thank God for the gifts, what I've seen in you, where you do excel, the choices you've made, different things. I don't know, but you see, sometimes there are things we can write. Don't wait until everyone's dead to write the precious thing. There are prayers. There are things that we can write to God on behalf. And Nicola, my daughter, is now 28, nearly 29, got two children. I was just out in Australia with her, and she said, when she was just going through a bit of a tough time, she said, I picked up your prayer. And I thought, no, this is who I really am. Because I thank God for you, Nicola, because this is what he's put in you, this is what he's put in you. I don't know if I could have said it all to her, but I said, this is what I pray over your life. This is what I love for you. So think about written prayer. I am not an artist, but I have seen some incredible people who paint. How many of you can paint and express? Do you know that your very painting, if it's yielded to God, can be a language to him? Father, I just want to paint the joy that I feel right now. I want this to be my love offering to you. That can be. Like I said, that precious girl who danced her prayer. I believe that we can worship, communicate with God, body, soul, mind, spirit, being. And so some of that is more creative outcome. You've got banners here. Many times here, people make banners as creative expressions to God. I think in, you know, I was going to say in the older days, you know, the kneelers, they were often designed as a sign of worship, of being an expression from their workplace. And of course, now they've become maybe old, traditional, and lost some of it. But there's a prayer language even in that. But what is your expression? Some, I already touched the whole thing, musicians. Pick up the guitar, pick up the instrument. When you're alone, chair. I bet you play and pray on that. But you see, that's the expression of your soul, if you just let that. I think some of the stringed instruments, I mean, look at David. They have such a power to pray, to call to God, oh God, hear my cry. It's something very supplicative, I think, about the stringed instrument. Beautiful. And so it doesn't have to be just words. And then finally, verse 14, how many of you ever cried? You shall sow in tears and reap the joy. You see, those very tears are part of your prayer. The lips, I think it's Spurgeon said, the liquid power, the prayer of tears has got a liquid power is yet untapped, or something like that. And how many, those groans, expressions, you see, beyond words. Why? Because it's body, heart and soul communication. And God wants you to have satisfied prayer. And pretty well, that's it. One last. You want to have satisfied prayer, there's one switch. Isaiah 56, 30. Come. Oh, there you go. These I will bring to my holy mountain. And this is what I felt for you. And I will give them joy in the house of prayer. So I want your house of prayer to be your happy house. I will give you joy. So why don't you come? Just pray. Why don't you stand with me? I'm sure you're ready to move.